is Jerry Steele. I will actually be the DOM for July. Jerry and I kind of switched it up due to my hectic June schedule, so I thank Jerry for filling in for me.
You're welcome, Bob.
If you need anything, call Jerry, they'll call me.
You better believe.
2 weeks ago, no glasses. Any updates to the prayer requests that are on the list right now? I did go visit Jesse Merritt on Thursday. He looks very well. The medications are doing the job. He's coming along, so just keep in mind that he will definitely be in there at least 20 more days. Jerry.
I saw Wayne Thursday afternoon at Fairhaven rehab facility, and he seems to be getting along fairly well at this point in time. It's going to take time to recover from that back surgery. I'm quite sure he'll make it. I don't know how long he's going to be at Fairhaven.
I'm worried all papers today all the time, but for some reason this week is awfully for her for chemo, but for some reason she's having the worst reaction this week than she's had when she's going through this, so I'm not sure for long. Just keep up on that.
I'll be on Victor. He's still doing good. His spirits are high. I got to hang out with him some on Friday. He's still hoping that he gets a call real soon. Update on my dad. He's still got the nosebleeds. He's got to put it on August 6th to see a doctor. And I got one pair of praise. They have found rescued 4 of the 15 boys that were trapped.
2 have been rescued?
4 of them now.
There were 6 when I left the house.
We'll get those numbers to you later. Okay. We pray for everybody involved in VBS this week. Kim just walked in, and all the hard work that's gone into the decorating. And I was looking at my schedule this morning, and the next 9 days I will be here at the church for one reason or the other. By the end of the week, we'll look rough. You're seeing it at our best. Trying to figure out the opening this morning, something caught my attention. Just thinking about the boys in Thailand that being rescued and Jesse being in the hospital and all the surgeries and all the sick people. And it's really put a tax on my prayer life this week, especially since I got the phone call a week and a half ago that Jesse was being rushed to the hospital. I know that Lee gave a long update on it last week, but I looked up prayer and I looked at several places, and this verse jumped out at me. It says, "Don't worry about anything, but in everything, through prayer and petition with thanksgiving, let your requests be made known to God. And the peace of God, which surpasses every thought, will guard your heart and minds in Jesus Christ." That just kind of jumped out at me. And, you know, they say to pray without ceasing. Well, it's been taxing this week, at least for me and my family. So just keep that in mind. Let's go to the Lord in prayer. Heavenly Father, we thank you for the encouragement and everything that you give to us, Father. You've heard all the prayers on this prayer list. Father, you know the outcome of each and every one, even the ones that are in our hearts that have not been vocalized and made public. You know the outcome, and your hand will be in every 3 months. Father, we please be with this church as we do the biggest outreach of the year and have VBS this week, and be with each and every worker and each and every student that comes in, and have them learn about you and Jesus and your glory and your grace. Father, be with now with the pastor and the rest of this worship service, as it was all intended to be in your glory. It's in your Son's name that we pray. Amen.
all three verses of the servant song.
Walk the good to see everyone here. We have some special visitors today. These ladies, we hope you make them welcome. My youngest grandson, Duke Allen Lee, is here, 6 weeks old. Judy and I had the privilege of watching Duke, who again is 6 weeks old, and Gracie, who is about 15 months old. And wow, you know, it's a challenge. It's a challenge. So we're glad to be here this morning. We're glad to be cognizant of the fact that we are anywhere at this point. This week is VBS. You saw the promo. You see the things around. It is not too late for you. You want to be involved. You want to get some kiddos you want to bring. They are welcome. You are welcome. And so we want to make sure that everyone is involved that wants to be involved. We're getting ready to wrap up this series. Let me say this. Saturday night, we're going to be having the movie, it's in your bulletin, we're going to be having the movie Samson. This is the one that they showed it in the theaters within the last year. And then we're going to do 2 weeks on Samson. Admission is free, just come. We provide the popcorn and the snacks. Just come, plan on having a good time. And this series, it's gone on a little bit longer than I had intended. But as I was studying the scripture, I just kept finding people, less than perfect people, that God figured out a way of using them. God figured out a way of taking their broken lives, taking their shattered dreams, and doing great things. In the sermon clip there, someone says, you know, I don't have much, I'm not worth much. And then we think of a small boy that said, all I've got is a small lunch, a few barley loaves, and a few small fish. And the Lord said, I'll take it. I can do something with that. And so it is in our lives. What we feel has very little value, what we feel is not significant, God can take that and multiply it and bless it to honor himself and his kingdom. Manasseh's mess is what we're going to be talking about this morning. Get this thing working here. Manasseh's mess. Now, the description in 2 Kings 21 talks about Manasseh, but some of the scriptures we're going to be referring to in Chronicles talks about his redemption, and that's where we're going to focus our attention. Let's bow our heads in a word of prayer. Now, Lord, we pray that you would open our hearts and minds this morning, that we would be open to your spirit, that you can reach in and touch our heart. And when something is said that is applicable, that the Holy Spirit will touch our hearts and say, that is for you. We just pray that we never forget that the great giants of the Bible were simple people just like us. And we pray that you would help us to realize that. In your name we ask, amen. Came across something the other day called the top 10 things you'll never hear your daddy say. Number 10, don't bother with your homework. Education is not all it's cracked up to be. Probably not going to hear your daddy say that. When I was growing up, we had it easy. Not going to hear dad say that. Here, honey, you handle the remote. Music today is so much better than the junk we used to listen to. Well, now that you're 13, princess, I want you to start dating older guys. Hey, it's prom night. Here's my credit card and the keys to my car. Now go have fun. Why do you want to get a job? I've got plenty of money for you to spend. We And then the number one thing that you never hear dad say, well, it looks like I'm lost. I guess I'll have to stop and ask for directions. Well, the reason I bring that up, we laugh about things that our earthly fathers or an earthly father figure, we know that they wouldn't say those things because they want what's best for us, even though we don't necessarily agree with that. But one thing, and the theme this morning, and has been, one thing you'll never hear your heavenly father say, you'll never hear him say, if you walk away from me, you can never come back. You will not hear your heavenly father ever say that. You'll never hear your heavenly father say, I am going to turn my back on you. You will never hear your heavenly father say, I disown you. Saul was the first king of Israel, approximately 1050 BC, followed by David and Solomon. We know about those. We learned about them in Sunday school. Now, from Saul's kingship to the destruction of Jerusalem when there were no more kings was about 464 years. Solomon was the last king under the, if you please, the United Kingdom. His son Rehoboam took the throne, but he was a dope. He was a jerk. And the northern kingdoms rebelled against him and said, we'll have our own king. And they had Solomon's other son, Jeroboam, to rule over them. So now we have a divided kingdom and two kings. And there were 39 kings between the two kingdoms for a period of time. The 19 kings of the north were all bad and always did evil in the sight of the Lord. Of the 20 kings of Judah, the southern kingdom, only 7 were good and pleasing in the sight of the Lord. Maybe 7.5, because Manasseh, who we're going to talk about this morning, was both a good king and a bad king. Manasseh reigned for 55 years. He reigned longer than any king over any portion of Israel. In the good king, bad king category, Manasseh was both. Let me explain. He started his reign at 12 years old. Hezekiah was a good king. Hezekiah was his father. And for the first 10 years, they reigned together when Hezekiah was alive. And then Hezekiah died. Now, many of you have heard about Hezekiah. There is no book of Hezekiah in the Bible, contrary to popular belief. Hezekiah is a book in the Bible the pastor usually cites when he wants something. When the pastor needs a new private jet because the prop plane is beneath him, he refers to the book of Hezekiah. When a pastor needs a new Bentley because the church Lincoln is not good enough for him, he refers to the book of Hezekiah. When a pastor skims $90,000 from the church because the $125,000 salary is too little for him, that comes from the book of Hezekiah. There is a pastor that if I mentioned his name, you'd probably never heard of him, but he did all of those things at his church. You might remember his secretary's name, Jessica Hahn, and the impact that she had on Jim and Tammy Faye Baker's ministry. See, Jim and Tammy Faye, the PTL ministry, was raking in $172 million a year. That was a lot of money back in the 80s. Say, Pastor, that's a lot of money now. Yeah, it is, but it was a lot more money back in the 80s. And this particular pastor thought that he would send his church secretary down there and blackmail so he could get himself a piece of that action. See, all pastors are not saints. That's why our eyes need to be on God and not on the pastor. There are pastors who are just in it for the money. There are pastors who are just into it for the fame and the glory. was a good king. Manasseh shared his throne for the first 10 years, but Hezekiah died. And Manasseh was officially king at the age of 22. And he was a wicked king. He stepped away from God. That's an understatement. He was running and sliding away from God down a greased slide. Now, we're all familiar with the prodigal prophet Jonah and his story. We're all familiar with the prodigal son. I submit to you this morning, we're going to be talking about the prodigal king, and that is King Manasseh. Now, these three accounts have something in common, not only with them, but with us. They all took steps away from God. Now, if you have your bulletin insert, I encourage you to fill these in so that you can review them this week and see if any of these things apply to you. If you're honest, they probably, one or two of them will. Steps away from God, and that usually is rebellion. We rebel against God because we think we know better. All of us who were teenagers at one time rebelled against our parents because we thought we were smarter than them. We thought we had more insight than them. We thought we knew more about the world. And then somewhere in our mid-20s, we started realizing, mom and dad weren't quite as dumb as I thought they were. They had a few things on the ball. Wow, it's hard to see. I will read it to you. The first thing is a restless attitude. The first step away from God of rebellion is a restless attitude. 2 Chronicles 33:2 says, he, Manasseh, did evil in the eyes of the Lord, following the detestable practices of the nations the Lord had driven out before the Israelites. Back in one section of 2 Chronicles 33, it said, Manasseh did more evil than the heathen nations that the Lord drove out before them. He himself was more evil than all of those other people. See, the prodigal son didn't just wake up one morning in the pig pen. He ended up there by making a series of bad choices and making a series of bad steps. He was always a child of his father, but he placed himself, he was in a position where the benefits of his father's resources didn't help him anymore. The father had plenty of money, and the prodigal son is living with the pigs. Manasseh's problem wasn't financial. Manasseh's problem was the guidance of his father was gone since his father died, and he had no other resource to keep him in line. The prodigal son and Manasseh both knew the right way, but they rebelled against it. They knew what was right and proper, and they decided not to do it. They wanted to do it their way, as the old song says. Now, here's the thing. Once you become a child of God, that relationship cannot be canceled. You will always be a child of your father. Now, the fellowship can be broken. The relationship can be damaged. But you are always their child. And that's the way it is with our Heavenly Father. When you rebel against your father and you break his will and break fellowship with him, you put yourself in a place where the blessings and benefits of knowing that father are greatly reduced or no longer yours. You can identify these bad steps, and it may help you determine if you need to come back to your Heavenly Father. Both the prodigal son and Manasseh can be summarized in the statement, "This place is no fun." The younger son, the prodigal son, experienced what all people, young people, feel one time or another. He got bored with his family life, and he wanted to explore the real world. He wasn't having enough fun. Both Manasseh and the prodigal son thought the grass was greener on the other side of the fence. But here's the thing, it's still got to be watered, and it's still got to be mowed. The restless attitude of the prodigal son in Manasseh resides in all of us. It goes by different names. In marriage, it's sometimes called the seven-year itch, although for some it itches long before and after the seven-year mark. I've heard of husbands and wives speak of feeling trapped. They want out because they're afraid they're going to miss out on some pleasure or experience by staying in their boring old marriage. I don't think any husband or wife wakes up one morning and decides they're going to be unfaithful or leave their mate. It always begins with this uncomfortable feeling of restlessness. Restlessness is the feeling that we are missing out on the fun. I've said before, I'll say it again. For those of you that are on Facebook, you're seeing the highlight reels of somebody else's life. Only going to post the good stuff. Now, I understand there are those DQs, drama queens. They like the scenic route, so they always take the dramatic way. They want people to feel sorry for them. But for the most part, you post the highlights of your life. I'm having a vacation here. I'm having a nice dinner here. This good thing happened to me. That good thing happened to me. Life is not a bowl of cherries all the time. Like Irma Bombeck used to say, sometimes life is a bowl of pits. Satan, well, you can go back to the Garden of Eden and discover that this human hunger is what got humanity in trouble in the first place. Satan told Eve, there's a tree, a fruitful tree. Oh, it's good to the eyes. Man, are you missing out? And Eve says, well, God says we shouldn't look at it, we shouldn't touch it. And Satan, oh man, did God really say? That's gotta be, look at that fruit. Man, that's delicious. You know, sometimes our minds and our eyes can play tricks on our body. I can remember this like it happened yesterday. Judy and I are driving, it might happen to you in a minute. Judy and I are driving down 95, heading for Columbia, and I started thinking about Red Robin in their blue ribbon burger. And on the highway, my mouth started to water thinking about that blue ribbon burger. Our minds can try and control the things we do. I venture to you that on that day, had we not been heading there, we probably would have changed our plans just because both of us were struck. 200 years ago, the hymn writer Robert Robinson spoke for all of us when he said, prone to wander, Lord, I feel it, prone to leave the God I love. Here's my heart, Lord, take and seal it for thy courts above. We need to recognize this dangerous feeling of a restless attitude, and we need to resist it like we would resist any other temptation. There'd be a lot less grief and pain in our lives if we could recognize this restlessness and resist it. It's like a monster in a cage. As long as you keep it in the cage, all it can do is roar at you. But if you let it out of the cage, you are headed for a heartache. The second thing, besides a reckless attitude, is reckless living. 2 Chronicles. He sacrificed his children in the fire in the valley of Ben-Hinnom, practiced divination and witchcraft, sought omens, and consulted mediums and spiritists. He did much evil in the sight of the Lord, arousing his anger. If there was something in the law that said don't do it, he did it. He wanted to experience the dark side of town, the evil side of town. He wanted every physical experience, regardless of whether God said don't do it. Like the prodigal, Manasseh let the monster out of the cage, and he was off in a flash. He was tired of his dad's old rules and decided to live by a new philosophy. No rules. Manasseh had unlimited money and authority because he was the king, and now it was party time. Now, the prodigal son, he had what he did not realize until later, limited money. He thought he had unlimited funds, but soon those ran out, as you know the story. Can't you see the bright lights, the loud music, and the late nights in both of their lives? They were going to have fun, till daddy took the T-Bird away, except daddy couldn't take the T-Bird away. He was nowhere around. They ate, they drank, they laughed, they were merry. Finally, they were free of daddy and his rules. See, with dad, there had always been rules. Can't do that. No, don't do that. His dad had told him that some things were wrong and some things were right. Now he decided, you know what? I'm making my own rules. If I think it's good, if I think it feels good, then it's right. And if it doesn't feel good, it's wrong. He had his own golden rule. He who makes the gold makes the rules. He was having the time of his life until his time ran out. There are some who have walked away from their Heavenly Father because they think that they don't want to follow his rules. They want to follow their own rules. The Bible does say that sin, there is pleasure in sin for a season. That means that sin's pleasure is only temporary, sometimes only momentary. Yeah, there's the drunken party, but then there's the hangover. There's that snort of cocaine, but there's always the habit that grabs you and won't let you go. Sure, there's the free sex, but there's also the unwanted pregnancy and the disease. Sin is like a lure fisherman used to entice a big old bass. You just throw a big bear hook in the water, no bass is going to bite on that. But if it looks pretty, shiny, and resembles something yummy they like to eat, what a surprise. Satan always baits his hopes with the most attractive, tempting bait. And before you know it, you are hooked, and you can't get away. Is that how you're living your life today? No rules? Third thing. It ends up with a ruined life. 2 Chronicles chapter 33, verse 11. So the Lord brought against them the army commanders of the king of Assyria, who took Manasseh prisoner, put a hook in his nose, bound him with bronze shackles, and took him to Babylon. One of the things the Assyrians did, they would put a hook in your nose, and then they would lead you around like an animal on a chain. See, the problem with sin is it never really truly satisfies. You get one high or one thrill, that's not enough. Soon you want something stronger and more thrilling. Sin never satisfies permanently, and eventually it leads to suffering. When Jesus added the detail of the prodigal son wallowing in the pig pen, the audience he was speaking to probably gasped out loud because it didn't get any worse for that than for a young Jewish boy to lose his money to the Gentiles and then end up in a pig pen. He hit rock bottom. The pig pen represents the ugly, putrid, hideous nature of sin. See, Manasseh, he wasn't in a pig pen, but he had a hook put in his nose, he was led by a chain, and he was thrown in a dark, dirty, smelly dungeon. See, these two set out to be free, but they soon became enslaved to their own sinful appetites. An alcoholic never plans on being an alcoholic. They just have one more drink. The problem that our society is having with the opioids, just one more pill or one more shot. Now, I certainly understand and comprehend that there's a problem with many doctors writing too many prescriptions. I've shared it before, that when I had open heart surgery a few years back, they sent me home with 82 oxycodones in a bottle. And I took two of them and I said, wow, that, boy, that's not for me. And I was talking with someone about it over in Brooklyn, and where they know about this stuff. Well, those were $10 a pill. And he says, I said, oh, those things didn't work for me. Well, did you chew them? Well, no, I didn't chew them. Well, that's why they didn't work for you. You're supposed to, you're not supposed to chew them. That's 8 hours worth of medication. Yeah, but when it hits you all once, I got rid of them in the proper way. But nobody, no addict ever planned on being an addict. It's just they engaged in something one time, and then the next time they needed a little bit more to get the same buzz, and a little bit more, and a little bit more, and pretty soon they're hooked. It's the same way it is with sin. It stacks up. When you run away from God and you live a life of sinful disobedience, you may think you're free, and you may be free of daddy's rules or the church rules for a while, but you are a slave to your own sin. There is an immutable law of God that says if you sow sin and disobedience, you will reap a bumper crop of suffering. Galatians 6:7 says, don't be misled. No one makes a fool of God. When a person plants, he will harvest. The old King James says, whatsoever a man or a woman soweth, that shall they also reap. And the law of sowing and reaping, the scripture gives it to us, sometimes 30-fold, sometimes 60-fold, sometimes 100-fold. You sow a sin, and that's going to come back to haunt you. Through the years, I've known hundreds of prodigals, teenagers and adults who once had a loving relationship with God, but they allowed restlessness and recklessness to enter their lives. Some walk away from God's blessings and they end up a mess. Some are still around, but that's because they've come back home to their father with their scars, licking their wounds, bearing the scars of those sins. That's the good news. The good news is you can still come back home to the Father. You don't have to wait till you're in the pig pen or tied up in a smelly dungeon with a hook in your nose. Ringing your nose. Anytime you want, you can decide to return to the blessing and fellowship with your Father. Here's how. How do we take our steps back to God and return? I'm going to go quickly here. If you've wandered away from God and allowed sin to take control of your life, it is not hopeless. There's always hope. First thing you got to do is realize your rebellion. Realize your rebellion. 2 Chronicles 33:12. In his distress, he sought the favor of the Lord his God and humbled himself greatly before the God of his ancestors. This is King Manasseh. Just like the prodigal son is sitting in the pig pen wanting to eat their food, what am I doing here? The scripture says, when he came to himself, Manasseh found that same place, sitting in a dungeon, a ring in his nose, tied up with a chain, and said, what in the world was I doing? What in the world was I thinking? He not only walked away from God, he ran in the opposite direction as fast as he could. With the prodigal son, verse 17, he came to his senses, the Bible says. This is the turning point of the parable. Before you can return to God, you must first realize you're in a mess without Him. Let's climb down in the pig pen with our boy for a minute. Excuse me, Porky. Oh, hi, babe. I loved your movie. This is our boy covered with the slimy mud and the mess of a pig pen. And if you've never been out to the farm and see how the pigs live, it will be a real experience for you. It'll bring a new sight, vision, and smell to the story of the prodigal son. He is so hungry, he's tempted to eat the pig food. but he can't even eat because the owner of the pigs won't allow it. He's being treated worse than the pigs. Finally, when he's as low as he can get, a light bulb comes on in his head. Click. Suddenly, he looks around, sees himself for who he really is. He looks down, and he is repulsed by the condition he finds himself in. Sin had blinded his eyes, but the light bulb of realization came on, and he could see that he was a mess. He had goofed up. He had done it all wrong. He reached the POTD, that's the point of total desperation. He hit rock bottom. For those who were here last week, we talked about rock bottom. It would be a good one to go back and view. He says, I do not belong here. This is not the place for me. I am made for something better than this. I am tired of sin. I'm tired of this slop. I'm tired. Manasseh said, I'm tired of these chains. I want to go home. Prodigal son said, I want to see my daddy. I miss my mama's food. I want to go home. God meets people when they realize they are POTD. Before he reached the POTD, he was proud. His attitude was, I'll never go crawling back to my dad and admit I was wrong. I'd sooner die in his pig pen than admit I was wrong. But when you get to absolute rock bottom, you get humbled in a hurry. Both Manasseh and the prodigal son humbled themselves. See, the only way you can approach God is with humility. King David was the child of God, but he walked away from God's rules and committed adultery and murder. He hid it for a long time, but finally came to his rock bottom and he repented. He broke down and wept before God and asked God to forgive him. This proud king was a broken, humble man. He makes a powerful observation in the midst of his own brokenness. In Psalm 51:17, David said, a broken and a contrite heart, O God, you will not despise. Your heavenly Father will never say to you, you can't come home again. Let me ask you, what's it going to take to make the light bulb come on in your head? You may be thinking, oh, it's not too bad for me right now. I'm not really a committed Christian. I'll go to heaven when I die, but I'm a long way from the pig pen. That may be true, but you don't have to wait till you're in the pig pen to turn back to your heavenly Father. Be smart. Come to your senses today and run home to your Father. Don't wait to be in the pig pen or in the dungeon. The son took three specific steps to return to the Father, and these are the same three steps that you need to take to return to your Father. First one is to realize. The second one, repent of your sins and shortcomings. We'll go quickly now. 2 Chronicles 33:13. When he prayed to him, the Lord was moved by his entreaty and listened to his plea. See, confession and repentance are two sides of the same coin. Confession occurs when you agree with God that what you're doing is sin and you need to stop it. David said, against you and you only, Lord, have I sinned. Next, he's willing to confess that he was wrong. He was willing to confess that he was wrong. See the change? At the beginning of the story, he was saying, give me, give me, give me, give me. Give me my inheritance. Give me my freedom. And then he was saying, make me, make me, make me. Make me one of your servants. Manasseh bowed down to other gods. He built altars to them. He sacrificed to them. Even his own children, he burned in the fire. At that day, Baal had giant hands, Baal and Moloch. Had giant hands, and they would heat that up to fiery red, and then they would lay young infants on there, and they would be burned to death before their eyes. Repentance means changing your mind about your behavior, and then being willing to change your behavior. See, Jesus is quick to forgive, but he requires willingness to repent. Remember the adulterous woman? And they came, and they came with stones, ready to pass judgment on her. And Jesus said, the first one, any of you that don't have sin, cast the first stone. And what did he say to the woman? Go and sin no more. Third thing quickly, return to God. Second Chronicles, so he brought him back to Jerusalem and to his kingdom. In their distress, they saw the favor of the Lord and humbled themselves greatly. I'm going to be singing a song in a few minutes for invitation. I've wandered far away from God. Now I'm coming home. The paths of sin too long I've trod. Now, Lord, coming home. I've wasted many precious years. Now I'm coming home. I now repent with bitter tears. Lord, I'm coming home. Coming home, coming home, never more to roam. Open wide your arms of love. Lord, I'm coming home. See, both the prodigal son and Manasseh found when they got to rock bottom, God was there waiting for them with open arms, and a forgiving heart. Third thing, restoration of fellowship with God. Go to the prodigal son again. What did the father do? He wrapped him quickly with the finest robe. Why? Because he was tattered, his clothes were dirty, he'd been in the pig pen. He looked horrible, probably smelled horrible. But what did the father say? Get the finest robe, the ceremonial robe. Probably, when they were having a big party, the robe that the father would wear since he was head of the household. He said, put that on my son to cover up the bad things that have happened to us. See, God is willing not only to cover our sins, he's willing to forgive our sins, but he's willing to cover our sins also. Put a ring on his finger. Now, that was more than decoration. We wear rings for decoration. That was the American Express Platinum card in that day. You could put the signet on that wax seal, and that would pay for it. What he did with the robe is he covered his sins so that he looked presentable. With putting the ring on his finger, he restored him to a sonship where he had the full authority and financial backing of the father. And then the final thing he did was he put shoes on his feet. See, servants didn't wear shoes. And by putting the shoes on his feet, he said, I will not accept you as a servant. I will accept you as my son, as part of the family. You are my son. You're not a servant. Manasseh's kingdom was restored. Theologians say he reigned for 22 years. In a godly fashion. He immediately started, you can read it in Chronicles, he immediately started tearing down the groves, tearing down the idols, restoring the temple. He lived a godly life. Here's the sad part about the story. It wasn't enough for his son. And although Manasseh repented, his son became king and went right back to the old way because his son did not get the message. And there were many bad kings after that. You and I have an opportunity here. Doesn't look like anyone sitting in a pig pen, but all of us have emotional ups and downs. All of us have situations in our lives we just can't handle, or we're tired of handling it. It's never too late turn it over to the Lord. Let's all stand together. We're going to have a song of invitation in just a minute. Let's pray. Now, Lord, we're thankful for the lessons of the Scripture. We're thankful that we can sit back, take a front row seat, and see how other people just messed up their lives. And Lord, that we can learn from other people's mistakes and not go down that path ourselves. We pray that during this time of invitation, if there's one here that needs to lay it on the altar, that needs to come back to you, needs to seek your forgiveness and restoration, that this will be the day. In your name we ask. Amen. Let's all stand together and we'll sing. It'll be page 309.
Oh.
6 o'clock, 6:30.
BBS thinks it's 6:30.
6:30.
6 o'clock, starting tonight, BBS up until Friday. After the service today, we're asking for 3 or 4 strong guys. We'll take 6 or 7 weak ones, we don't care. Help us down at the house just for about 2 minutes. We just have to move the playset back into place, so if someone can help us, that'd be great. Any other announcements?
We'll get about business meeting next Sunday after church. Bring a little something to snack on. We're going to eat and conduct business.
Like to thank Lee Falk and Brian for replacing the 75-foot cable going up to the projector, so VBS would work a little bit better instead of all the flickering and fallouts.
We do have a sauna now at church. Just put you up in the attic.
Also, a reminder, next week we're going to be voting on all the offices and committees. Please let someone on the nomination committee know whether you'd like to work in a position or are willing to keep the position you're in.
Real quick, if you're on the nominating committee, raise your hand. There you go, let us know.
Children's lives will be impacted for your kingdom. In your name we ask. Amen.
Amen.